Shalom Chavrim, I'm Steven Ben-Nun, your Washington Institute of Biblical Research, and it's been quite some time since I actually spoke to you guys, and I know there's a way that you can probably click on this to where you can have all of our latest videos uploaded. I am intending to share quite a bit of messages here in the next coming week here. In fact, it'll probably be day after day for a little bit here, especially because of course, we've been all week in the Passover week, the Exodus journey, and I haven't even begun to teach on that at this time of year, which I like to try to do. Of course, I've been very sick as well, just been struggling along with Israeli News Live, making sure we keep the news up and running, but it's more important to speak about biblical things that are happening than I think it is to deal with news, and I've really kind of shirked that responsibility, so I apologize for that. I wanted to come back, though. This was something I was sharing on Israeli News Live the other day, but the video had stopped recording because the memory card had filled up, and I didn't realize I was that full. On Daniel 11, beginning there with verse 39, but I wanted to come back to this because I really felt like that what got cut off, a lot of people have no idea what you were missing on that, so I really wanted to come back and fill that blank spot in here on Ben-Nun Institute. So let's get right into this. And by the way, today was a priestly blessing in Israel. Just for those of you that are not familiar with this, this is part of the Passover ritual in Israel. And the picture really here does not even do it justice here at the Wailing Wall, the number of people that are packed in there. If you've ever been in Israel during this time, that is the day that more people than any other time will go to the Western Wall. Unbelievable, unprecedented number of Jewish people will go there. And we're talking about, you know, well, they have on there 80,000 people, excuse me, packed at the Western Wall there. And even all the way down through the Jewish quarter, etc., while the wall is all packed out, it'll be packed out through there as well. I mean, practically cannot even walk. There'll be so many people. And, of course, Israeli security is always there on hand because of this time and the fear of violence. And, of course, violence has struck today as well. Stein, who's a friend of ours here on Twitter, he had posted this morning that there was an attack on the light rail system. One woman was critically injured in this attack here, and very sad news to hear that that is actually happening there. But let's get into this prophecy in Daniel 39. I think it's very important in light of the things that are happening in the Middle East right now. And he says, and he shall deal with the strongest fortress with the help of a foreign god. Now that he shall deal with the strongest fortress with the help of a foreign god, I believe was the British Empire. The United States is an extension of that British Empire, by the way. The foreign god is the Vatican itself. When they made an alliance with Britain, they rebuilt back up their relationship before World War I. A lot of people don't realize that. They were kind of on outs with one another. There was a lot of tensions between the British and the Catholic Church there. But when the British saw the Ottoman Empire allowing the Jewish people to return to their ancient ancestral homeland and buy land in this region of the world, something they had never allowed before, then the Catholic Church could not stand for the Jews to go back to their ancestral homeland. Because, after all, they were going to be the very ones that were part of the greater Israeli project. The Zionist project that really has nothing to do with the true Jewish people. This is something that was put together by a lot of what I call fake Jews, even though they may be Jewish by birth, like the Rothschilds. But they were going to put this plan together to be able to take over that entire Middle Eastern section. All right? Now, here's what happens, though. Says, and whom he shall acknowledge and shall increase glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many, and shall divide the land for a price. All right, now, who causes them to rule over many? That's a little bit of a mystery how this is actually worded there. Is it the foreign god that causes Britain to rule over many, or is it Britain causing the foreign god to rule over many? Well, either which way, they both do rule over many. And the Vatican clearly rules over many provinces of the world, even though they don't do it with a military power. And of course, Britain and the United States together also have just dominated the entire globe. I mean, we run Japan, we run Germany. I say we, the United States, because of being a citizen of the United States. Britain, they've colonized Africa and Australia, and just all over the world is just really ran. Actually combined together, the two together really run the entire world. But here's what's interesting. If you look at the same verse, verse 39, and shall divide the land for a price, doesn't say the word land in Hebrew. There's no arets there at all in the Hebrew language. But instead, it says that they would divide the adama, the earth. Take a look at it right over here. Right here. Ve'adama, not haaretz, not Israel. Because see, Israel is often referred to as haaretz, the land, or arets, the land there. Okay, but it doesn't say ha'aretz. It says ve'adama ikalelk. See, they will divide the land or the earth for a price. So I think this is a little bit different than the prophecy of Joel that speaks about dividing my land. See, in fact, if we look over at that, let's take just a second and go over to Joel. Now, as we go over here into Joel, and it's a little bit confusing because I believe in the King James Version Bible, and I'll just quickly show you here on eSword, just so you can see that. You actually have this in Joel chapter 3, verse 2. And I will also gather all nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat and plead with them there for my people and plead for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. All right, now that's Joel 3:2. Now in the Hebrew Bible, it's actually Joel chapter 4. And we go down to about, I think it's about verse 5 or 6. Let me just see here real quick here. Maybe it's for, no, I'm sorry, it's chapter 4, verse 2. I apologize. So again, Joel chapter 4, verse 2. And I will gather all nations and will bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I will enter into judgment with them there for my people and for my heritage, Israel, in whom they have scattered among the nations and divided my land. All right? Now, here's the whole thing, though, and this is what a lot of people are not, they totally miss on this here, and divided my land. Ve'aretzi, see? That's my land. Ve'aretzi, God saying my land. See? Chiliku. Chiliku, excuse me, chiliku. They have divided my land. Again, now you're dealing with aretz, which is the way it is referred to Israel in many cases in the Bible there. But in Daniel, it's not talking about the aretz, it's talking about the earth. They divide the earth for a gain. And I find it fascinating. So many biblical scholars have totally put these two together. I've even done the same, putting the two together, and it does apply to Israel as well, but it goes beyond the borders of Israel, speaking about the entire earth being divided up. I think a lot of this has to do with the Middle East, but then again, maybe it does have to do with the 10 regions of the world that they want to do in the last days. And even in the book of the Apocalypse of, I believe it's Apocalypse of Thomas, or it's the Apocryphon of Abraham, I forget which one of the Apocryphon books there, it's interesting to note that they would gather the lands unto themselves. See, they do it for greed, or it's one of the Apocryphon books. I forget which one that is actually in there. But clearly, even for an Apocryphon book, even if you don't consider that any kind of inspirational book, we have to remember our own inspired Bible tells us that if there be one who is spiritual among you as a prophet, I, the Lord, will make myself known to him in dreams and visions. And if what he says comes to pass, I'm fearing, for I am with him. Now that is in Amos chapter 3, if I remember right. All right, so when we look at these apocryphan books, and there is a prophecy in there, and we see the prophecy coming to pass, then that is of God. All right, so we can't say it's not of God. So I just kind of throw that in there sometimes. Some people don't like to speak about these books, but there are so many prophecies in these books. The book of Enoch just filled with prophetic things that are happening here in our day. Okay. So here they are, they're dividing the land, or the earth in this case, and not just Israel. That's what's happening in the Middle East. They have been dividing this up. All the way back, you go back to 1920, because again, there's a covenant that is made here between Rome and this foreign god, which is, Britain, and this foreign god, the Roman Catholic Church. And they've gone together, and they have warred world wars. World War I beginning this all, then World War II, then World War III, which is about to come about now. Basically, it's already started. But even World War I, what'd they do? Topple the Ottoman Empire and divided up the land. For what? For gain. Well, the France got the French mandate, which was Syria. The British mandate was giving a Jewish homeland in 1920, was giving them all of Jordan and everything west and east of the Jordan River. Well, they didn't go along with that so well because, well, they forgot about Hussein, who fought along with the British Empire to topple the Ottoman Empire. And so they had to remember his son, King Abdullah II. So they give him a whole country there of his own. Well, why? They're dividing up the earth for gain. Something that benefits their pocket. So they give that over to him. And of course, Israel now has everything only west of the Jordan River. Well, that didn't work too well because we forgot the Moabites that are part of the Ammonite kingdom there that we see. And remember, this is something I got to bring out to you. This, because we're going to get into this in just a moment anyway. In verse 41, we'll get to that. Well, let me go ahead and let's read on down so we get to that part so I can bring this all out. In verse 40, and at the time of the end shall the king of the south push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind with chariots, with horsemen, with many ships. And he shall enter into the countries and shall overflow as he passes through. He shall enter also into the beauteous land, and many countries shall be overthrown, but these shall be delivered out of his hand, Edom, Moab, and the chief of the children of Ammon. He shall stretch forth his hand also upon the countries, and the land of Egypt shall not escape. All right, now let's quickly just drop in the Google Maps here because I think it's important to kind of give you a visual of what we're looking at right here. Because so much what people do not understand about the Middle East here is what's going on. So they enter in into this Middle Eastern section here. Now, Edom and Moab and the chiefs of Ammon escape. Well, Edom is Rome, right here on your map there. Look at it, Rome, Italy. See, as Rome's going to be that seat there, they escape. They say, well, that's not even part of over here in the Middle East. But you got to remember, though, what happens here in Daniel. He speaks about not only Moab and Edom and the chief children of Ammon, but then he says, and he shall stretch forth his hand also upon the countries, and the land of Egypt shall not escape. But he shall have power over the treasures of gold and silver and over all the precious things of Egypt, and the Libyans and the Ethiopians shall be at his steps. All right, so let's go back to the maps. The Libyans, the Egyptians, they're at his steps. Also the Ethiopians right here, down here. The Slovak language there, so they have it a different name, but this is Ethiopia here. This is all of the steps. And right now, the Catholic Church is, along with the United States and the British there, they are conquering Ethiopia through another coup, just like they did with Egypt and Libya and all these countries along here. But what did they do? Now, notice the scripture says that they enter into the land. All right, watch what he says here. All right, so He shall enter also into the beauteous land, and many countries shall be overthrown. It's not just Israel. This is not Joel's prophecy, friends. Many countries shall be overthrown. Doesn't even begin to name all those countries. Why? Because maybe they're not countries. I don't know. Let's look. So what do we have here? He does. He enters into Iraq, overthrows Iraq. Really, we overthrew Kuwait as well. Even though we delivered Kuwait, we still have conquered Kuwait. Saudi Arabia, well, they're at the beck and call of whatever the United States says, right? All right, so we have Syria becomes a French mandate. They don't overthrow Jordan. That's interesting. Why? That's the chiefs of Ammon. They gave them that country. This used to be all promised to a Jewish homeland. Why? Well, it's part of the greater Israeli project. But they're not going to overthrow that because that's not what they wanted to do. But notice this. This is what you need to see here. And also, they don't overthrow Moab. In ancient biblical times, this here, well, down here was called Edom, but the Edomites moved to Rome. Because why? David and Saul overthrew Esau's children, but only one escaped, and that was Hadad. What does Hadad do? Hadad flees down here into Egypt, and he goes over there, and the Pharaoh raised Hadad as his own son. And then when he becomes of age and David is dead and now Solomon reigns, what does Hadad do? He asks this Pharaoh if he can go back to his homeland. Well, he doesn't go back here to where his homeland is. He goes to Syria and becomes the king of Syria. But he also has Pharaoh's wife's sister to be his wife. But he comes and reigns over here. Later he moves into northern Africa. Why? Because he's part of the Egyptian Empire. And then they go according to Obadiah and they rule in modern day Italy in the Roman Empire. All right. So, but it speaks about this being Esau. This was Ammon. And here, not up into Damascus, but in this area right here, this was the Moabite children. Now the Moabite children are on this little thing that looks like a kidney sitting inside of Israel there. And that's called the West Bank. All right. And this is where the Moabites are. Now, they're going to take away Jerusalem as well. They're going to make that an international city. This is what they're doing now. And by the way, the Google Maps right here, as I shared with you a little while back, they've already redrawn the lines. You see these dotted lines? That's the new West Bank according to what? The 95 Oslo Accords. And the other day, when we came down Highway 1, this is considered Jerusalem, but that's going to be the international Jerusalem, that checkpoint called the Eco Bridge that we told you was going to be a checkpoint. They had a checkpoint right there. They had turned it into a checkpoint and were checking people at 3 o'clock in the morning coming into Jerusalem. Not going out, though, coming in. I thought that was interesting. Why? Because it's part of the West Bank on that side. They did that intentionally to be able to use it as a checkpoint. And this is why the prophecy also talks about that the children will be on the coastline, and this talks about Ashkelon. See, Ashkelon, the city right here down below Tel Aviv, says we'll be in this area here. Prophecy. This is when we're going to be delivered, no less. As a child, this is when our eyes come open, is when we're having to dwell on the coast and not in Jerusalem. But Micah prophesies we'll return to Mount Zion. But then he says, why are you in travail? Why are you, is there no king in there? Remember Micah chapter 4, how he speaks about that? And then he says, you will be driven out and you will dwell in the plains. Well, there's your plains right there. You'll be dwelling down here because we'll be driven out, right? Why? All of this dealing with Daniel 11. That's exactly why. So, Egypt, Libya, and Ethiopia shall be at his steps. But tidings out of the east and out of the north shall affrighten him. Who's the him? The him is that, because remember, what did Britain and the United States do? They formed NATO. The Catholic Church is the United Nations. United Nations gives birth to NATO, the alliance. The European Union is given birth by the Catholic Church. Let me just show you something about that, just to show you how powerful the Catholic Church is. See, Pope with EU leaders. Okay, and then just put the word life. They needed him to breathe some life back into the church there, right? Where is it at? Here it is right here. Looky there. Now, you don't even get to see it good in that picture. Give me a different picture. There we go. Let's put that picture where everybody can see this rascal. Blow it up big enough. There's the Pope of Rome. All the European Union leaders there in your picture right there. They went to him to breathe life back into the European Union. Angela Merkel right in behind there. I can't even, the French president, gosh, I can't even tell, recognize half of them as blurry, but I can see some of them that are just obvious people we see every day, right? So that's who's running the European Union. The Pope of Rome is, as part of his greater, remember, they're going to make a new world army out of the European Union. Why do you think the U.S. sent all this military equipment into Europe? It's for their new army. That's what Steve Pigeon shared with us, that they purchased that equipment. Ah, very interesting, isn't it? All right, so we go back over here to see what it says. So tidings out of the north, literally it doesn't say out of the north, but it says from the north in Hebrew, from the north, will trouble him. Mi metzara u metzafon. So the troubling comes from the north. That's Russia. It only troubles him. Doesn't say he can't overcome the problem, but it troubles him. And it says out of the east, these two tidings trouble him. Now, I was saying the other day, let me just show you something here. I said the other day that I was beginning to think that maybe China is working with the United States to overthrow North Korea. All right. And I could be wrong on that. It's really difficult for me to tell what's really going on. All right. And then my good friend Lorenzo here on Already Happened, he shares this article. It's a Taiwanese article here. But this was a video that he saw of China moving on North Korea's border, the S-300 system they got from Russia. Now, we already know, and it is a fact, they moved 150,000 troops to the northern border of North Korea. Now, I haven't looked to see exactly where this group is here yet. Not via a map as of yet, but they moved these here. All right, here it goes. China's northeastern Shandong Highway suspected of emergence. Okay, but let's see. Well, we won't. It doesn't really matter where they're going to at this point here. But the point is China is getting all around the borders of North Korea. Is it to invade North Korea, which is what I assumed to begin with, or are they going to try to help defend North Korea from the United States? So, but here's the thing. Trouble out of the east troubles him, and also trouble out of the north. Is it because China is going to defend North Korea like Russia is defending Syria? Or is it North Korea, period, because North Korea has nuclear weapons? Maybe North Korea is that trouble that bothers him. Nonetheless, no matter which way it is, maybe China's come to the rescue of North Korea like Russia came to the rescue of Syria, and that's what's troubling him. But let's take a look at what Daniel says here. All right, they shall. The word affrighted him is really, I don't know if that's a good word to use right there. It's almost like it infuriates him, you know? He's just bothered by it badly. And he shall go forth with great fury to destroy and to utterly make away many. Goes with fury now. Now remember, the king of the north, friends, is the Pope of Rome. It's not the president of the United States. It's not the king of England. It's the Pope of Rome. He's the one that runs his NATO force and his U.S. allies and his British Empire. And it makes him so angry, he sends them in with a great fury to make away many. That's why I noticed the other day when the President of the United States, you know, I said this is not going to air on Israeli News Live. Maybe we should air this on Israeli News Live. But the President of the United States, I'm listening to him myself. All right, he is sitting there congratulating the first responders of the I-85 accident in Atlanta, Georgia, the awesome job they did. And I appreciate President Trump doing this for these men and honoring them in the way that he did. You know, really it should be the men that were there on the ground, not so much just their leaders, all right? But he honors these guys. And At the end of that broadcast, which, by the way, the White House YouTube channel cut it off when they loaded it on YouTube, but I was catching it live. But at the end, a reporter asked him, did he authorize the strike on the Moab bomb on Afghanistan? And I was blown away by his answer. He doesn't answer and say, yes, I authorized it. He skirts around it. We have a great military, great guys, great bunch of guys, dedicated, like these guys are dedicated. And, you know, he says, I've authorized our military to take care of things. But he doesn't answer it directly. My wife gets in the car, and I'm saying to her, I'm blown away. I said, I cannot believe that the president just answered the way. I said, he doesn't even answer that he authorized the strike. I'm thinking, okay, am I the only guy that recognizes this, you know, that the president actually skirted around that? In fact, I've been stating now on Israeli News Live for some time, I said, is the president really in charge of the U.S. military or somebody else running it? Because it doesn't seem like he does. Not from my standpoint. I didn't think he does. And I wasn't the only one that noticed that. Then the next thing I see, TASS Russian news, Sputnik Russian news. And some people think, well, you know, Steve, you're just a Russian agent. I get that. You know, we get it in the comments. We just delete those kind of comments. I am no Russian agent. People forget that we're here in Eastern Europe, which was part of the former part of the Soviet Union. My family speaks and understands the Russian language as of growing up in that. So we have utilized the gift that is in my family that understands the Russian language to be able to research Russian news, to give a heads up for those on Israeli News Live of the things, the way that the Russians are thinking and what we see coming that we don't get to see in the Western media. And some people, it's really funny, they say that the Russians support Steven Ben-Nun. No, it's the kind giving of those that follow in America, Canada, and Europe, places like that. In fact, I don't think we've ever had a gift from Russia at all. I believe that there are believers, Christian believers in Russia as well, but I know that they have a very difficult time in life as it is. And so I would rather see them put it to feeding their families in the first place. But anyway, that's really nothing to do with that. The point is we research from the Russian side because it gives a balance to what's going on in American media, especially with so much propaganda. And that's coming out from specialists in America. So when we do Israeli News Live, we try to balance those things out because we do see so much propaganda. And I see it on the Russian side as well. And we expose that and we see it on the Russian side too. Just strange things sometimes that happens. Like one thing that I was able to run into, never could understand, was Russia was already giving Russian passports to Crimean citizens 10 years before 2014. But then I began to understand why, because the Crimean people had been doing referendums for almost 20 years to go back to the Russian Federation. And the Crimean or the Ukrainian government was refusing them every time. But that's an internal issue. But nonetheless, we see these things and we always try to balance things out. Don't want to get off onto that. Let's go back into this teaching here. Very interesting. So anyway, these issues from the north and from the east have frightened him. I'm sharing this, some of these thoughts here with you as it's laying on my heart. Even with, because I've been back and forth, you know, is it maybe the out of the east? Is it North Korea that troubles him? Or maybe is this China going to stand up for North Korea like Russia standing up for Syria? And that's something totally new. I never thought about that until I'm putting this together. So I don't know. I really don't know the answer to that. But nonetheless, I do know that NATO is going to send all their ships, all their war people. They're going to do what? Make away many, kill a lot of people. Just like when President Trump dropped this Moab bomb in Afghanistan. Friends, do you realize how many innocent children were killed because of that? And people applaud this and they say, oh, this is all great and everything. He's getting rid of ISIS in Afghanistan. You know, what happened to the greatness of America where precision-guided bombs were used in order to take out those that were the evil ones so that you could spare some of these children? You know, you drop that big of a bomb. I mean, my God, how many women and children that don't want any part of this ISIS, like you have in Mosul? How many women and children are just used as human shields. And they tell you this, they testify this afterwards, but they come out all mangled up from all the bombs, you know. Not to mention, it was the United States that created ISIS in the first place, under Barack Hussein Obama. Maybe they should have called him Barack Insane Obama. Jeez. So we go into verse 45. And he shall plant the tents of his palace between the seas and the beauteous holy land, holy mountain, and he shall come to his end, and none shall help him. You know, I believe this is because what happens at the very end, when the Pope of Rome is able to put together the third temple so that he can put maybe his alien Antichrist in there. I don't know if the Pope will be the one or if it's actually going to be some demonic being incarnate in flesh that'll end up being put inside the third temple as their savior. That is supposed to be the one, not the Yeshua that came 2,000 years ago. But anyway, it's really troubling to me. But he does come to his end. Why? Because God will not support this greater Zionist project that the Rothschilds are doing that are destroying all the people there in the Middle East. But what God will support is God will support the Orthodox, or not so much the Orthodox, but just the Jewish people, period, that are in the homeland today, to just really from their heart want to see the coming of the Messiah. He will support this. And he will come and defend those Jewish people. You know, the government, yeah, they're there. There's some really good people in the government. I do believe that. And I do believe that even Rabbi Yehuda Glick, who's a parliament member there, I believe the man really has a good heart and he means well. I really believe he does. But I believe that there are some in the government in Israel that are all about this greater Zionist project as well, that have not the good intentions of the Jewish people at heart. And they're going right along with the bombings and the killings and the murder of people in the Middle East. Totally going against the Torah that God had given us, that states in there that we're to be at peace with our neighbors, not to go in there and murder them all. You know, and we can expect nothing but you reap what you sow. But God will have mercy on his remnant. Remember, the Bible says, and I shared that with you in Zephaniah the other day, he hides his remnant. Well, you didn't see it, guys, because you're those of you that don't watch Israeli News Live, let me take you to this. I think it's very important that you see this. Let's quickly run over here to Zephaniah. And let me share this beautiful passage here with you. In Zephaniah chapter 2. There's a lot of people that believe in a rapture. Well, there is a rapture. It's in the Old Testament here. But some people do get it kind of confused. We think of tribulation and we say, well, you know, we have a pre-trib rapture. We believe that God will spare us all the horrendous things that are happening. Well, the Christians in the Middle East are not being spared from their tribulation at all. There is a man-made tribulation that is not what God is talking about sparing the people from. But he talks about that he'll spare the people from his own anger. And his own anger comes against the world for the evils that they're doing to humanity. And that's what we find right here in Zephaniah chapter 2. Before the decree bring forth the day, verse 2, when one passeth in the chaff before the fierce anger of the Lord. Let me make this a little bigger. I apologize. I wasn't even thinking about this. You guys need to be able to see these things. Before the fierce anger of the Lord come upon you, before the day of the Lord's anger comes upon you. Not Donald Trump's anger, the Pope's anger, or the anger of Russia, or the anger of China, or any of these guys. It's not their anger, but God's anger. Seek ye the Lord, all you humble of the earth. Meek is another way of putting that word there. The meek of the earth that have executed his ordinances. That have, in other words, that have kept his commandments. Seek righteousness. In other words, do the right thing. Seek humility. It may be you shall be hid in the day of the Lord's anger. So there is a hiding away of who? The meek or the humble of the earth. See? Those that are willing to do righteousness, the right things that keep his commandments, the ordinances, you know, let me just, out of curiosity, just out of curiosity, meek of the earth. Let's just define this. Let's see what is the meek of the earth. Well, the meek shall inherit the earth, the Sermon on the Mount that Yeshua gives. Yeshu is actually the way his name was given back during the times of the apostles. You know, I saw this in vision, and I wasn't even going to say things to people about it. But I did. I saw this in vision not too long ago, and I came to my wife and I told her, I said, you know, I've seen in vision the time when Yeshua was on the earth, and I was watching the apostles as they spoke to him, and I heard them call him Yeshu. And I'm like, I didn't know that. That's weird. You know, and I thought just that's just something I just kind of keep to myself, you know. But as I began to see that, I realized, actually, when Yana did the interview with Rabbi Ariel Cohen, which I'd like to air that on this channel as well for you guys. Some people misunderstand him, and that needs to be addressed as well. But he says to Yana in the interview, he says, you know, Jesus, you call him Yeshua. He says, but Yeshua is not what we called him. He said, the Jews never called him Yeshua back in his day. He said, they called him Yeshu. And I'm like, are you serious? And he spoke about how that the ayin, the letter ayin at the end of Yeshua, he said, he is Yeshua. He wasn't saying that he's not. Yes, he is Yeshua. He says, but during these times here, we didn't use the letter ayin as a vowel. We did not add a sound to it. He said, so we actually called him Yeshu. And I'm like, that's very interesting. And it confirmed what God had placed in my heart. So anyway, what does blessed are the meek mean? The third beatitude is blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Jesus' words also from Psalm 37, which says the meek will inherit the earth there. Well, I was hoping we'd get just a simple definition of this. But anyway, take your time, look it up. And go back and look at the Beatitudes as well. I'm Steven Ben-Nun. You're watching Israeli News Live. I trust this has all been a blessing to you, especially what we have just spoke about here from Daniel, from verses 39, chapter 11, all the way down to 40, 45.